Welcome to everyone. Today we have the great pleasure to welcome Anne-Sophie Bonnebendia, who is the head of the POEMS Laboratory. So POEM is a laboratory between CNRS, INRIA, ENSTA, and it is located on the campus of Institut Polytechnique de Paris-Palaiseau. And Anne-Sophie is going to talk about black hole waves at corners of a metallic particle. Please, Anne-Sophie.
Thank you, Sébastien, and thank you very much for the invitation. And yes, I will present several results that we have obtained with my collaborators in POEMS concerning a strange phenomenon that occurs at corners of a metallic particle, which we call a black hole phenomenon. And okay, so je vois comment ça bouge pas. Sorry. Okay, so typically I will consider such a very standard scattering problem where you have here in green a scatterer which is in a vacuum, and you have here an incident electromagnetic wave. And what is specific in the problem we are interested in is that we suppose that the material inside the scatterer is what I call a negative material, in the sense that at least one of the two electromagnetic constants, epsilon and mu, is a negative real number. And here I will suppose, in fact, that epsilon is a negative real number. And we will see that the combination of the fact that I have a negative material and that the scatterer has corners will be responsible for some unusual phenomena. Okay, so usually when I present this work for people who are not physicists, I explain why it could be relevant to consider negative epsilon. So I will briefly recall that. First, for application to plasmonics, when we consider metals as in an optical frequency range, because you know that metals are dispersive materials with a permittivity epsilon, which is a function of the frequency omega. And a simple example of such a function is due to Drude. This is a Drude model, which is recalled here. So you see epsilon as a function of omega. Epsilon zero is permittivity in vacuum. Omega P is a plasma frequency, and gamma is some parameter which allows to take into account the dissipation in the metal. And what happens when you try to fit this function with experimental data is that, for example, for metals like gold or silver here, gamma is quite small compared to omega P, so that when you plot both the real part in blue and the imaginary part in red of epsilon over epsilon zero, you notice that below the plasma frequency, in this frequency range which corresponds to optical frequencies, the real part of epsilon is negative and the imaginary part is small. So that we can, in a first approximation, neglect this imaginary part. It is what I will do. And also, I want to mention that this sign change of the real part of epsilon is responsible for the presence of surface plasmonic waves, which travel at the boundary, at the surface of the metal, and which are useful, for example, for the miniaturization of optical devices. And a second application is the application to metamaterials, so now which are artificial materials, typically obtained by a periodic assembly of small resonators, and which can be modeled again in some frequency range by a negative permittivity and possibly also a magnetic permeability. And so the justification of effective models for such materials is something very interesting from a mathematical point of view. There have been a lot of contributions to this high contrast, so-called high contrast homogenization, which which is absolutely not the purpose of my talk. I will just take epsilon negative without justifying it. And now what is interesting is that at the interface between a negative index, such a negative index material with a negative epsilon and mu and vacuum or dielectric, we have a negative refraction, which allows, for example, the realization of perfect flat lenses. Okay, so this is the end of the physical introduction. And now, I am not a specialist of physics. I am an applied mathematician. And what I will consider in the sequel is such a model problem. In fact, I will be in 2D. It is a 2D problem. And I consider a transverse magnetic polarization so that Maxwell equations are reduced to a scalar equation, which is written here, a Helmholtz equation, where U is a scalar quantity now, which is in here the transverse perpendicular to the picture component of the magnetic field. So we are in a frequency domain. Omega is a pulsation. And we consider such a scattering problem that I have already presented. And so what is important is that epsilon now is equal to a positive value, typically the permittivity of vacuum in the yellow region, and it is a negative real number in the green region. And because I consider this polarization, the fact that mu is positive or sign changing has no influence. What is important is the sign change of epsilon, which appears here in the equation. So we consider a scattering problem, which means that U, the total field, is a superposition of a given incident wave, typically a plane wave, plus some scattered wave that we would like to compute. And as usual, we will impose to the scattered wave to be outgoing by imposing such a Sommerfeld radiation condition at infinity. Okay, so this problem is completely standard when epsilon is positive. But what is different here is that epsilon is sign changing. And in particular, when we have corners, it will lead to some difficulties that are illustrated here by numerical experiments. So here, what we have done is a finite element simulation with a completely usual code. So on this boundary, we use some Dirichlet-Neumann condition, but it is not the purpose of my talk. It is very classical. And so epsilon is sign changing. And more precisely, here I take the contrast. What I will call the contrast in the sequel is the ratio between epsilon inside, epsilon one, and epsilon outside, epsilon zero. So epsilon one over epsilon zero takes a value which is close to minus one. We see that minus one is a very particular value. But for mu, I suppose that mu is constant everywhere. And what you have is three results obtained with three different meshes. You see that we increase the number of nodes. And so first, outside the scatterer, you obtain a very standard diffraction pattern. Inside the scatterer, there is nothing because mu is not size-changing, so there is no propagation of wave inside the scatterer, typically like in a metal. But epsilon is sign-changing, and due to this sign change of epsilon, as I have already mentioned, you have a plasmonic wave, a surface wave, which travels at the surface of this triangular scatterer. Okay, everything is very well, but what is not so good is that when you refine the mesh, you can observe that these plasmonic waves, in fact, is changing. There are phase shifts, and in fact, there is no convergence. What happens is that you can refine the mesh, there is no convergence, you can observe no convergence, and what happens is that the corners have an influence on the plasmonic wave, which is mesh dependent, which is absolutely not satisfactory. So the reason is the appearance of strong singularities at the corner. at the corners. And the objective of our work is, and the objective of my talk is to explain what are these singularities and why we have this problem, and to find a remedy, to obtain a method which is convergent. Okay, so there will be three parts in my talk. First, I will describe these singularities, which are this, also these black hole waves, as I mentioned in the title. Then I will explain what is the remedy that we have developed, which is relies on a complex scaling approach. And finally, I will apply the method to compute the plasmonic resonances of a particle with corners. Okay, so first we want to understand what happens at a corner. So we make a zoom at a corner. So this is a small disk around one corner. So this corner has an angle capital phi. And I introduce the polar coordinates, r and theta. And of course, around the corner, epsilon now is only a function of the angle theta. Okay, it is epsilon 1 here and epsilon 0 outside. And so, of course, it is a natural near the corner to try to separate the variables to obtain particular solutions. So we begin with the equation in Cartesian coordinates in this disk, and we introduce the polar coordinates, and we can rewrite this equation in polar coordinates. But what is for me less usual and very useful here is to introduce not only the polar coordinates, but the Euler coordinates, which are deduced from the polar coordinates by replacing r by z, which is the logarithm of r. And it is nice because just r d over dr is equal to d over dz. So that this equation now in Euler coordinates take this form. So I say that it is nice because for these two first terms, except that epsilon, of course, is a function of theta, now we have constant coefficients. And in fact, these two terms can be written exactly like that, divergence of 1 over epsilon gradient of u, exactly like the equation in Cartesian coordinates, except that now the divergence and the gradient are with respect to the Euler coordinates. Okay, so this part of the equation is very nice. Of course, now this part contains this r squared, which is written due to the definition of z exponential to z. And also the price to pay to have this simple operator is that now the problem is not set in a bounded domain, the disk, but in a semi-infinite strip. Because of course, when you go to the corner, r tends to zero, and so z tends to minus infinity. Okay, so z is unbounded, theta is between zero and two pi, so you have a semi-infinite strip. So what is, notice that this exponential, which tends to zero at infinity, so where we are interested in at the corner, it is infinity, this term is neglectable. And so what we can do, in fact, to study the singularities which appear at the corner is to neglect this term. It is, can be justified. And so it is a quasi-static approximation of the equation. Okay, so now we will consider this last line, this simple equation, which is written in Euler coordinates in a semi-infinite strip, and we want to find particular solutions, which are the modal solutions with separated variables in theta and z. Okay, so we will look for particular solutions, which are of the form phi of theta exponential lambda z. Lambda is unknown. It is what we call a singular exponent. And so we want such a function to be a solution of our equation in the semi-infinite strip, which is represented here. And of course, the solution has to be periodic in the angular variable theta. So you plug this form in the equation and you obtain this eigenvalue problem. It is a 1D eigenvalue problem where phi is just a function of theta and lambda squared, the square of the singular exponent, appears as an eigenvalue. So it could be, you can think that it is a very simple 1D eigenvalue problem, but in fact, it is a very complicated eigenvalue problem because epsilon is sign changing. And because epsilon appears here and here, we have no theory for this problem. And in particular, it is not self-adjoint. And we will see that we have complex eigenvalues. So it is difficult to do the theory of this problem, but fortunately, it is a 1D problem with step constant coefficients. So we can compute by hand the solution. And it is what we do. And what we find is that all the singular exponents, all the eigenvalues, we say that lambda is an eigenvalue, it is abusive. If and only if lambda and kappa, you remember that kappa is a contrast of permittivity, lambda and kappa are related by a dispersion relation. And the expression of this function f phi is given here. Phi, you remember that it is the angle, the corner angle. And so you notice that this dispersion relation is defined if kappa is not equal to the bad value minus one. So we will suppose that kappa is always different from minus one. And so we can consider, solve now this dispersion relation to compute the singular exponents. But before explaining what we obtain, I will just give a classification of the different solutions that we can obtain. First, of course, lambda equal to zero is always a solution associated to a constant phi. So lambda equal to zero, phi is constant. It is just the constant function u. Not very interesting, but it is a solution. And then we can obtain lambda with a non-zero real part. So if the real part of lambda is not zero, you have an exponential here, which is either decaying, either increasing at minus infinity. And we will only consider the evanescent solution, only this solution evanescent at infinity. So with a positive real part will be physically relevant. And finally, we could also obtain some eigenvalues, lambda, which are perfectly imaginary number. Okay. So if lambda is an imaginary number, I beta, you see that this is like a propagating mode in a waveguide. It is oscillating in Z. And so this last case is interesting because precisely when epsilon is positive in a standard case, when epsilon is positive, it is very easy to show, multiplying by phi and integrating by parts, that lambda squared has to be a positive real number. So when epsilon is positive, all the lambda squared are positive real numbers, so that in fact we have only a real lambda. And in particular, we have no propagating modes. So the propagating modes, the existence of propagating modes will be the main consequence of the sign change of epsilon. And more precisely, what we show by a careful study of the dispersion relation is that there exists exactly one propagating mode, in fact, two, because of course, lambda appears as lambda squared. So if lambda is a solution, minus lambda is also a solution. So we have one propagating mode if and only if the contrast of permittivity belongs to some interval that I call the critical interval. So this critical interval can be obtained explicitly, and it is given by this expression where this number r phi is 2 pi minus phi over phi. So first remark is that minus one, the bad value minus one is always inside the critical interval. And then also what you can notice is that when phi is small, r phi is very large. So the critical interval is very large for a small angle. At the limit, when phi is equal to zero, the critical interval fills all the negative real axis. And on the contrary, if you have no corner, if you have a flat boundary for phi equal to pi, you obtain that r phi is equal to one. And so the critical interval contains only, in that case, the value minus one. And in between, for instance, for a right angle, pi over two, for example, you find that the critical interval is minus three minus one third. Okay, so typically, this is what you obtain when you plot all the singular exponents lambda in the complex plane. On the left, for a contrast which is not in the critical interval. So because it is not in the critical interval, on the imaginary axis, you have only the solution lambda equal to zero, corresponding to the constant mode. But now, if you take a contrast in the critical interval, you obtain in addition two values, I beta and minus I beta, on the imaginary axis. So now what is important is to know which of these modes will contribute to the physical solution, for example, in my scattering problem. So these are the modes written in Euler coordinates, and it is most usual to see the same function in polar coordinates. So since z is a logarithm of r, r is the exponential of z, and so this is just r to the power lambda. And so what happens is that if you consider the singular exponents with a strictly positive real part on the right-hand side here, you obtain modes which are exponentially decaying, as I have already said, in the infinite strip. And in polar coordinates, we obtain solutions which tends to zero near the corner. They are physically relevant and they will contribute to the solution. On the contrary, if we consider the singular exponent with a strictly negative real part, we obtain modes which are unstable, exponentially increasing at infinity in the strip, which are singular near the corner and not physical. They are too singular. They do not contribute to the solution. And what is not clear is the status of these two propagating modes, which correspond to some singularities at the corner that I will describe more precisely now. Okay, so let's have a look at the solution when lambda is equal to I beta or minus I beta. And now I will denote this solution by S plus and S minus, S for singularity. So this term r to the power I beta, I prefer to rewrite it exponential I beta logarithm of r, which makes clear that this function, as a function of r, becomes more and more oscillating when r tends to zero. We have a strongly oscillating behavior at the corner when r is equal to zero. And we can represent such a solution now the isovalues. And what we observe is that we have two plasmonic waves traveling on the edges of the corner, which are coupled in such a way that you see that the wavelength tends to zero when you approach the corner. This is typically what I will call a black hole wave. So these solutions are strongly oscillating at the corner. First result to an important result. And also I want to say that when kappa is close to minus one, when kappa tends to minus one, beta tends to plus infinity. So this oscillating behavior becomes stronger and stronger when kappa goes to minus one. A second important remark is that when you consider the gradient of such a function, it behaves like one over r near the corner. So it is not square integrable. And if you go back to Maxwell's equation, it means that the classical electromagnetic energy of such a solution is infinite. which seems to be very, very strange. Maybe the reason is more clear if we consider the problem in the time domain. The same solution is the time domain, adding the time dependence exponential I minus I omega t. And so we have a way we can compute the phase and the group velocity, and we can show that it behaves like R. So it tends to zero when you approach the corner, which means that you have a wave which propagates to the corner, but when it approaches the corner, it goes slowlier and slowlier and slowlier so that it never reaches the corner. And it is why there is an accumulation of energy which leads in the frequency domain to an infinite energy due to this phenomenon at the corner. And so it is what we have called the black hole phenomenon. This terminology may be not the best one, but it was a terminology already used by other people who observed black hole waves for other applications, for elastic waves or for water waves. But for these examples, they need to introduce a more singular geometry, a cuspidal geometry to observe black hole waves. While here, because of the sign change of epsilon, a simple corner leads to this black hole phenomenon. Okay, so we have these propagating singularities, these two propagating singularities, but still we have to discriminate between both of them to know which one propagates towards the corner and which one propagates from the corner to infinity. So to fix idea, we suppose that beta is positive, and so we want to discriminate between r to the power I beta and r to the power minus I beta. So we have to compute, for example, the sign of the group velocity, but another possibility is to use the so-called limiting absorption principle, which consists in remembering that in the material, in fact, there is some dissipation. So we will suppose we will add to the material some dissipation by introducing a small imaginary part to epsilon one in the inclusion. And we want to observe what happens to the singular exponents. And when we compute the singular exponents, first here, for example, it is an example without dissipation and then with dissipation. With dissipation, again, on the imaginary axis, you have only the solution lambda equals zero. But what we observe, of course, due to the dissipation, all the values of lambda are slightly moving in the complex plane. And in particular, the two yellow points corresponding to the propagating singularities are moving. This one, for example, is moving on the left-hand side, and the other one in the right-hand side of the complex plane. And since we know that the singular exponent with the positive real parts are physically relevant and not the one with the negative real part, it means that finally, the only physically relevant propagating singularity that I have to take into account, even in the non-dissipative case, here the corresponding to minus I beta, because it is the limit of a stable mode when the dissipation tends to zero. Okay, so it is just an illustration to explain what we have done systematically for all the possible configurations. So what we have obtained for an acute angle phi is summarized by this here. Je ne sais plus comment dit tableau here. So if the contrast is smaller than minus one, then the physical correct propagating singularity is S minus. I call this singularity the outgoing propagating singularity because it propagates in some sense outside the domain, going into the corner. But when kappa is greater than minus one, the correct outgoing singularity is S plus. And in addition, I want to mention here that when kappa is smaller than minus one, the singularities are skew symmetric with respect to the vertical axis. We say that they are odd modes, while for kappa greater than minus one, we obtain symmetric modes, even modes. Okay, so it will be important in the sequence. So please remember that for kappa smaller than minus one, we have odd modes, and for kappa larger than minus one, we have even modes concerning the black hole wave. Okay, so finally, what we have done mathematically, but I will absolutely not enter in the details. When kappa is in the critical interval, for example, now I have something which appears. I cannot read my slide. Okay. To fix idea, we consider that kappa is smaller than minus one. What we have proved is that the solution cannot be chosen as a finite energy solution, which means here that it is not in the space H1 of function in L2 with a gradient in L2, but it is a superposition of a function V which is in H1 plus some constant, which depends on the configuration and on the source, times the outgoing singularity, which is here for kappa smaller than minus one, it is correspond to minus I beta. And so we can prove that we can set mathematically the problem in a new functional framework where we look for a solution of this form, and we can prove that the problem is well posed using some complicated techniques that I will not discuss. I just want to mention that concerning the uniqueness of the solution, it is simply a consequence of an energy conservation combined with the Sommerfeld radiation condition at infinity. And I just want to explain what happens concerning the energy. When you want to compute the energy balance, for example, in a large disk, which contains the scatterer, what you obtain is that the usual term here, which corresponds to the energy flux through this boundary gamma R, now is balanced with a new term, which is completely unusual in red here, which is the energy which goes into the corner, which is a positive energy, which means that in general, of course, it depends on C. If C is equal to zero, this term is equal to zero. But in general, some energy will be leaked in the corner. So we will see a lot of consequence of that. And now in the second part, the question is how to compute such a solution. You have seen that standard finite elements are not able to capture this black hole wave. I have shown you some results in the introduction. And so what is the idea? The idea is that for the computation, I have replaced a small disk around the corner by a semi-infinite strip, just considering Euler coordinates instead of Cartesian coordinates. And so now the infinite strip is an unbounded domain, and the black hole wave is exactly a propagating mode in this infinite strip. So numerically, what we do is exactly what we would do in a waveguide to truncate a waveguide with propagating modes. And the solution is to use what we call the perfectly matched layers, PML, which consists mathematically just in introducing in the equation a complex scaling. Roughly speaking, it means that the derivative d over dz, okay, z, remember it is the logarithm of r, d over dz in the equation, it's just multiplied by a complex parameter, the complex scaling parameter alpha. And so the idea is to choose alpha in order that the black hole wave, instead of being oscillating in the strip, will become exponentially decreasing in the strip. It is the idea. And so one can understand what happens by considering the modes that we have computed before, remember, which were solutions with separated variables, this form. And this is a plot of the values of lambda in the complex plane before introducing the complex scaling. Now, if we introduce a scaling, Z is just divided by alpha, which means finally that everything happens as if the lambda were divided by alpha. So the new singular exponents due to the complex scaling are lambda, the lambda before the complex scaling divided by alpha. And this transformation, lambda gives lambda over alpha, since alpha is a complex number, this transformation is the combination, the composition of a rotation in the complex plane and a dilation. And what is important is this rotation, because you see that if alpha is well chosen, the effect of the complex scaling on these two propagating modes in yellow is exactly the same as the effect of dissipation that I mentioned before. And it is what we want. Now, this this yellow point will correspond to an exponentially decreasing, decaying solution in the strip. But because it is just a scaling, it does not affect the solution everywhere where you do not make the scaling. So the idea is the following. Finally, instead of solving the problem by finite elements in the whole disk, we will cut a small disk around the corner, and we replace this small disk by the strip. And so we consider the equation, the initial equation in the perforated disk, but for the disk which is replaced by the transform into the strip, we use the equation written in polar, in Euler coordinates, z theta, and in addition, we introduce the complex scaling, which makes appear alpha here and here. And of course, we have to match the two solution, which is not the two equation, which is not difficult. We have to impose a periodicity in theta. And finally, because we know that now, due to the scaling here, the black hole wave is exponentially decaying, we can truncate the strip and we impose some boundary condition, for example, here, a Neumann boundary condition here. And so for this problem, we can use finite elements and it works very well. It is an example of what we have obtained in the case of a triangular inclusion. So here we have three corners. And we have cut, in fact, three small disks around these three corners, which have been replaced by a computation by finite elements in three strips, which should be semi-infinite, but we have truncated them for the computation. And also the dashed lines here, here, and here indicates that at the left of the dashed line, we introduce the complex scaling. Okay, so the solution is modified only at the left of the dashed line, but here it is the physical solution, but in the Euler variable. So for example, for this top corner, we observe a black hole wave, which is excited at the corner. And thanks to the complex scaling, here it is absorbed in this PML without any spurious reflection. But for example, if we consider this corner here, here you see that we have no black hole wave, we have an evanescent mode, which is decaying before going into the PML. Here we don't need, in fact, the PML for this particular computation. Okay, so this is what you obtain. And now we are very happy because what we observe is that you remember that before introducing the complex scaling with a naive simulation, we have observed that there was not no convergence when we increase the number of nodes. And now, with the complex scaling, everything is very nice. The solution is stabilized, and we can prove the convergence of the method. And it is also very nice to see an animation in the time domain, a movie where just I multiply the solution by the time dependence exponential I omega t. Now it is for a contrast of minus 1.5. Again, I will compare a solution with the naive finite element method and with our new method with a complex scaling at the corner. And here I will use an incident wave which is Q-symmetric in order to enhance the phenomenon. And what you observe is that on the left, without complex scaling, you have a non-physical resonant effect, while on the right-hand side, you see the black hole wave which propagates to the corner. So the solutions are completely different. And we consider that the solution at the right-hand side is the correct one because it is the limit of what you would obtain with adding a small dissipation. Okay, so finally, in the last part, I will explain what happens if you compute the plasmonic resonances of a particle which has corners. These are the most recent results that we have obtained, in particular, they have been obtained by Florian Monteghetti. So now we consider a particle here in green, which is filled with a negative material of permittivity epsilon 1, which depends on omega, which is embedded by a positive material of permittivity epsilon 0. And I will consider that the whole system is a bounded one. And we are now interested in finding the frequencies omega for which this problem has non-trivial solutions U. So you see that I have added a Dirichlet condition on the outer boundary gamma, which could be replaced by a Neumann one. It has absolutely no importance for the following results that I will present. Okay, so this is an eigenvalue problem, but in general, what is frequently done by people computing plasmonic modes is to consider that the particle is small compared to the wavelengths, so that we can remove this term and consider the quasi-static approximation. And we will do the same here, so we will remove this term. But omega still appears because epsilon 1 here is a function of omega. However, omega is hidden in epsilon 1. And for the analysis, we can forget omega and consider that the eigenvalue is not omega, but kappa, the contrast of permittivity epsilon 1 over epsilon 0. Of course, if I compute kappa, I can recover a posteriori omega. Okay, so I will consider the quasi-static problem with an eigenvalue, which is kappa, and I can rewrite the problem equivalently like this. So I look for complex values of kappa such that there are non-trivial u solution of this problem. So u has to be a harmonic function, both in the yellow domain omega zero and in the green domain omega one. It is equal to zero on the outer boundary. And what is more important are the transmission conditions at the interface between omega 1 and omega 0. So u has to be continuous, but the normal derivative is not continuous. And precisely, the eigenvalue kappa is the constant of proportionality between the two normal derivatives from omega 0 and from omega 1. This problem can be written in a variational form like that, where it is clear that it is an eigenvalue problem, where kappa is an eigenvalue, but I want to point out that it is a very non-standard eigenvalue problem. A typical eigenvalue problem is such that you have here a rigidity term and here a mass term, but here you see that we have rigidity terms in both sides of the equation, But here you integrate only in omega 1 and here only in omega 0. And this problem is mathematically absolutely not trivial. And there are a lot of studies concerning this problem. And in particular, what is well known is that there is a self-adjointness, which is slightly hidden, but the problem is self-adjoint, so that all values of kappa, in fact, are real number. And the case which is generally considered is a case where the particle has a smooth boundary, a smooth particle, and in that case, one can prove that all the solutions form a sequence, an infinite sequence of negative eigenvalues, which converge to minus one, always these values minus one. And here I have plotted an illustration corresponding to the case where both the boundary of omega one and the boundary of omega zero are ellipses, and where analytic formulas are available. And in that case, and because it will be useful in the sequel, in the end of my talk, I distinguish between the modes which are symmetric or skew symmetric with respect to the horizontal mid-axis of the domain. Okay, so these even modes are associated to a sequence of eigenvalues here in blue, and these odd modes are associated to a sequence of eigenvalues here in red. And both sequences converges to minus one. And you can observe, it is very specific to this example, that here all the eigenvalues are greater than minus one. In general, you can have eigenvalues smaller than minus one, but here they are all greater than minus one. Okay, and you observe that the modes correspond to, again, to plasmonic surface waves that travel on the boundary, on the interface between the positive and the negative material. But the resonance appears only for very particular values of the contrast. Okay, so the question is, what happens if you have a corner? There are few results in the literature, but there are some concerning the corners, in particular from these two contributors. And what is well known is that due to the corner, they appear a continuous spectrum. Before, we had only discrete eigenvalues converging, accumulating at minus one, but now we have a continuous spectrum. And this continuous spectrum is exactly the critical interval that I have introduced before. You remember the formula of the critical interval, which depends on the corner angle, capital phi. So what happens, in fact, is very similar. It is the title of the slide. It is very similar to what happens for scattering problems in unbounded domain. In fact, due to the existence of black hole waves, the corner plays exactly the same role as infinity in unbounded domains. And what happens is that some of the energy of the modes will leak in the corners. And so what we expect is to have exactly like for a scattering problem in unbounded domain, we expect to have complex resonances or quasi-modes or leaky modes. There are several terminologies in the literature. And so we want to illustrate that by finite element computations. And so the question is, we take our previous case without corner, with a lot of eigenvalues, and we introduce a small corner. Due to this small corner, we have a continuous spectrum which appears. And the question is, what happens to the eigenvalues of the unperturbed ellipse? And similarly to a scattering problem, we can expect two possibilities. In general, the eigenvalues will move in the complex plane, and they will become complex resonances, we call complex plasmonic resonances. But more rarely, but it can occur, that these eigenvalues will stay real eigenvalues, and they are what we call embedded eigenvalues because there are eigenvalues inside the continuous spectrum. And to know what happens, we will use again methods that are used for problems in unbounded domains, and again we will use our complex scaling because it is very standard to use perfectly matched layers to compute scattering resonances. So we use the ideas that I have presented before. You see that we have cut a small disk around the corner. This small disk is replaced by a strip written is which corresponds to the Euler coordinates, and we introduce in the left part of the domain is in orange here a complex scaling with an appropriate parameter alpha. Okay, so we solve the eigenvalue problem with this complex scaling. And what we expect is that the complex scaling will produce a deformation of the continuous spectrum. In fact, we can predict this deformation analytically. So this is illustrated here. The dashed line corresponds to the critical interval, to the or equivalently to the continuous spectrum. So you have two parts, one part in red and one part in blue. And maybe you remember that the part in red corresponds to odd modes and the part in blue to even modes. Okay, and now, due to the complex scaling, this continuous spectrum is deformed in the complex plane, and the deformation is indicated by the continuous line. So the picture on the left-hand side is for one value of alpha, and on the right-hand side for a different value of alpha with a larger argument. And when you increase the argument of alpha, you increase the deformation, and you make appear a very nice logarithmic behavior, you see, of the curves at the value minus one. So what we expect is that the complex scaling, by deforming the continuous spectrum, will unveil the both embedded eigenvalues and complex plasmonic resonances. But because we consider a very specific example where before the corner, the eigenvalues were all larger than minus one, we will focus on the blue zone at the right-hand side of minus one. And this is what we obtain. So the black crosses correspond to the eigenvalues that are obtained numerically. Okay, the value of minus one is here. The real axis is here. So what do we observe? First, we observe that the continuous spectrum has been nicely discretized. All these black crosses correspond simply to a discretization of the deformed continuous spectrum. But in addition, we obtain several eigenvalues, some of them on the real axis and some of them with a non-zero imaginary part. And what we want to know is to relate, we want to relate these eigenvalues, which are for the ellipse with the corner, to the eigenvalues of the ellipse without the corner. So we have superimposed the eigenvalues of the ellipse without the corner for even modes in blue and for odd modes in red. And what appears very clearly is that the odd eigenvalues have been very slightly modified by the presence of the corner, contrary to the even eigenvalues that are strongly modified. And it is very easy to understand why, because you know that this part of the continuous spectrum in blue corresponds to even black hole waves, so that if you take an odd eigenvalue, the eigenmode is an odd mode, so it is very, no, it is just not coupled to the black hole wave, which is even. So you have no coupling, you have no leakage of this mode in the corner, only a very slight modification, which makes the cross slightly move inside the square. But on the contrary, if we consider an even Eigen mode, it is coupled to the even continuous spectrum, to the even black hole wave, and so there is a leakage, and this leakage will produce an imaginary part. So the blue eigenvalue move to the complex plane and become complex plasmonic resonances or quasi-modes or leaky modes, as you want. And so this is the end of my talk. So the message is that the corners at a sign-changing interface produce hyper-oscillating singularities that we call black hole waves. And that to obtain a stable approximation of these black hole waves by finite elements, this requires a specific treatment near the corners, like, for example, a complex scaling, which is an efficient solution. And what I want to mention is that also the mesh everywhere has to be done very carefully. And in fact, we need to use a mesh which is symmetric with respect to the elliptic boundary. Because if you don't use a symmetric mesh, you obtain such spurious modes, even with a very fine mesh. And it is really impossible to avoid that, except if you use a very specific mesh near the surface. Okay, so these were the 3 points. And now what to do? Of course, we are interested by the three decays. For instance, the case of a tip, of a conical tip like that. What is funny is that contrary to the 2D, now we can have several black hole waves that propagate towards the corner. And what has been proved in this paper is that they prove the possibility of existence of infinitely many embedded eigenvalues. Also, we can consider 3D Maxwell equations, which is the subject of the PhD of Maran Riani. Also, we would like to investigate the nonlinear plasmonic eigenvalue problem that occurs when you don't make the quasi-static approximation. You remember that I have removed this term, but with this term, we have really to consider this problem as an eigenvalue problem for omega, and it is a nonlinear eigenvalue problem. And several people are working on these nonlinear eigenvalue problems. But of course, this is a work of mathematicians, and there are a lot of questions concerning the relevance of such a model physically, in particular, close to the corners. And so I thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Anne-Sophie, for this really, really nice talk. So I've got obviously questions of my own, but first I would like